The final phase in the construction of the John Labatt Center is on right now. And right now is the best time to get your London Knights season tickets, because you just might be the lucky winner of a fabulous box for an action-packed Knights game. 10 tickets in a luxury suite for you to enjoy, courtesy of the London Knights. Your chance to win it starts when you visit us online or pick up the phone and call 681-0800. Individual tickets for exit.
The calendar, but it is now forever etched in our memories as the time when one of the worst terrorist attacks in history took place in the United States of America. This is the first anniversary, obviously, of those attacks. This morning, you're not going to see any photos or pictures of planes flying into buildings here this morning. I think we all have that burned into our memories. We are going to look forward and see how things have changed since 1 year ago today. Hawaita will be joining us live from Windsor Fire Services. There are a number of events planned for that location, as there are across the world, including the Rolling Requiem. Mozart's Requiem will be sung in different time zones all across the globe, including here in London at Centennial Hall. Matt Webb will be joining us live from there. We will also take you live to Ground Zero for the official ceremonies in New York, as well as in Gander, Newfoundland, where Canadians are going to commemorate this date, September 11th. It is much cooler outside today than we have had for the past few days. Those wild storms moved through last night, knocking out power in many places and also causing some problems on the roads with falling branches. Those are being cleaned up right now. Jay will have your full forecast. It will be a sunny day, but cooler. 22 degrees, the forecast high for today. First, though, here's an update on your morning news.
Thank you, Bevan. Good morning. I'm Bob Smith. Well, less than 2 hours before the U.S. officially begins the marking of the tragedy of September 11th, the country remains at a heightened state of alert this morning. 9 U.S. embassies have been closed overseas, and security has been tightened around federal buildings and U.S. landmarks at home.
While car bombs are a very significant part, car bombs, truck bombs, explosive devices, we also know that the terrorist community has been interested, and Al-Qaeda in specific, and their associates have been interested in a wide range of terrorist devices.
Now, for the first time since the tragedy, the U.S. has raised its terrorist warning level to orange. That's the second highest level. Despite the move, President George Bush is telling the American people to keep on living their lives.
We have no specific threat to America, but we're taking everything seriously, obviously.
Meantime, U.S. Homeland Security Director Tom Ridge says every marshal in the country will be part of airline flights for the next several days. Well, as if to underscore the importance of being prepared, unidentified attackers fired 2 rockets this morning at the airport in the Afghan city of Khost. A spokesman says the rockets exploded in an open field just east of the airport where U.S. Special Forces have a base set up. No one was hurt, but security in the city has been tightened and police are searching cars for explosives. And extra precautions are also being taken today in Washington, D.C. All around the U.S. Capitol, mobile missile launchers have been armed with surface-to-air missiles. The Army's Avenger Air Defense System can fire 8 Stinger missiles at one time. The exact locations of the portable air defense equipment are not being disclosed for obvious reasons. This is the first time since the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1961 that portable air defenses have been set up around Washington. And Premier Ernie Eves says we shouldn't take our freedoms for granted. Eves, who is scheduled to fly to New York later today, says the attacks had an incredible impact upon everyone, including him. He says it's important to cherish family and friends and remember the important things in life. The Premier will attend a function at the site of the World Trade Center towers later this week. Well, in other news today, several hundred people demonstrated outside of Toronto Hall, where former Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu spoke. Both Palestinian and Israeli waved flags and shouted slogans at each other. Earlier Tuesday, Netanyahu was met by protesters in Ottawa. While there, he said he saw the same glint in the eyes of Montreal rioters on Monday as he had seen in Middle East terrorists. Netanyahu was on a mini Canadian tour to promote an anti-terror campaign to raise funds for Israel. Here at home, the hunt is on for one man who escaped from the Bruce County Jail in Walkerton. 36-year-old Joseph Hill, formerly of Ayton, escaped from the jail on foot on Tuesday. Police say that he scaled one of the exterior walls. Hill was in custody on allegations related to serious firearms offenses, uttering death threats and several breaks, entering thefts. He's described as a white male, about 5'7" tall, weighs about 150 pounds. He has blue eyes, wavy brown collar-length hair. Police warn that he may be armed. Well, last-minute talks are continuing between the CAW and the Avon-Maitland School Board in an effort to avoid a strike by the board's custodial staff. The 117 custodians could walk off the job by midnight tonight. A letter will go home with students today. It outlines plans in the event of a strike.
I'm very optimistic that there won't be a strike because negotiations have been amicable. I'm hopeful that we can get an agreement. If there is a strike, we will try to keep the schools open as long as we can with due regard to student and staff health and safety.
Okay, so it will be business as usual regardless of the strike, at least in the interim?
We will try to keep the schools open as long as we can. The only thing that would change for schools would be that community use in the evenings would not take place.
To sports now and a final glimpse of the Stanley Cup in London. Some rule changes coming for the NHL, and the Blue Jays are on a three-game winning streak. John Cleveland has all the details now in today's Sports Wrap.
This New Day Sports Wrap is brought to you by London City Chrysler Jeep and Dodge Truck.
The Indians gave the Jays the win last night at Jacobs Field. Ninth inning, Mark Wohlers turns a double play ball into the winning run for Toronto as he throws the ball into the outfield. Shannon Stewart comes in to score, and the Jays beat the Indians 5-4. A.J. Pierzynski tripled for the Twins against the Tigers.
Superman might walk again someday. Christopher Reeve once said he wished he were dead after a 1995 fall from a horse left him a quadriplegic, but his doctor is astonished by his recovery. Reeve is now able to raise his right hand and move the fingers on his left hand and the toes on both feet. He can also feel pinpricks over most of his body. Reeve is also able to breathe now without the help of a respirator for up to 90 minutes at a time. And finally this morning, Warner Brothers is offering some films for download over the internet now.
Did you ever make anything happen? Anything you couldn't explain?
Dear Mr. Potter.
Included on the list is Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. It can be downloaded for a fee of $3.99 US for a 24-hour viewing. Older films from the studio can be accessed for $2.99. So I think we've been thinking it wasn't long before you'd be able to get movies over the internet, and it looks like that time has arrived.
Well, technology is incredible.
It is amazing.
Also incredible is the story about Christopher Reeve's recovery.
Astonishing.
I mean,
he always said he hoped that one day he would walk again, and people thought, well, it, you know, it's nice of him to say that, but with that kind of a severe spinal cord injury, it just doesn't seem to happen, but he's getting better.
There are signs, yes, that he's getting better, and you just wish the best. It somehow still seems ironic that he's Superman.
I know, and because, again, the very technology we're talking about with the internet and everything else, that kind of technology being employed now in these sorts of injuries, who knows, maybe he will.
All right,
hope
thank
so.
You very much, Bob.
Right.
Jay's coming up next with your forecast.
This land was made for you and me. This land is your land. This land is mine.
You're now en route to entertainment, dining, and travel.
How would you like to win a two-night stay at Selma's Cottage?
Events taking place commemorating the events, the terrorist attacks of a year ago. In London, Centennial Hall is the focus of our location this morning. The Rolling Requiem will start there at 8:46, exactly 1 year to the minute that the first plane hit the towers in New York. Matt is there this morning. Matt, how are you?
I'm well, Bevan. How are you this morning?
I'm okay.
Yeah, we are live at Centennial Hall in London on Wellington Road. The performance will start at 8:46, like you said. It is known as the Rolling Requiem today, normally known as the Requiem by Mozart, completed by one of his peers. We're going to hear a little bit of the history of that by Gerald Fagan, who's conducting today's performance. Being performed today by the London Fanshawe Symphonic Chorus, the Gerald Fagan Singers, and the Concert Players Orchestra. There are more than 175 choirs around the world performing today's Rolling Requiem. Each performer around the world donning a badge with one of the names of one of the victims that lost their lives in the terrorist attacks in New York City 1 year ago today. So we're going to talk, our first guest will be Gerald Fagan. We're going to talk with him, find out about the Requiem and about today's performance. It is open to the public. Doors open at 7:30 a.m. And if anyone out there is watching right now wants to come down and reflect, they can come down, and as long as they're in the seats by 8:30, it's open to the public.
Thank you very much, Matt. And I understand that there is no charge for...
There is no charge.
Thank you, buddy.
Talk to you in a bit.
In Windsor, Hawaita is at Windsor Fire Services, where a number of things are taking place. Hawaita, good morning.
Good morning, Bevan. That's right. Today at around 9:45 here at Windsor Fire and Rescue Services, they are going to be doing a commemoration at 9:45. Now, this is open by invitation only, but this is going on across all of North America, from my understanding. So today's a day that there's going to be a lot of things going on here in Windsor. We do have this as well. We're going to be having a psychologist on later on the show. We're going to have a few things going on here, excuse me, as well.
Thank you very much. We'll talk to you shortly.
You're very welcome.
All right. Of course, the events of September 11th 1 year ago, a great concern for parents as to how that is perceived by the children. So today will be a challenging day for educators. But on this first anniversary, we thought it would be suitable to stop by a school and find out just how the kids are dealing with this. Over the course of the program today, we will give you their presentations through poems that they have written. These people are from St. Jude's Catholic School in London, and here is the first poem.
911. A crash, a boom. The world changed forever. The building shuddered. We shook in fear. A dream, a nightmare. Our heroes rushed up, going above and beyond, never to be seen again, never to be forgotten. Friends, no, heroes, rest forever. 911.
If you're interested in commercial properties, visit the new PL Classified section to download floor plans from Old Oak Properties. Now you can compare costs, amenities, and locations in just a few minutes. In downtown London, you'll find space in the Talbot Center, Dufferin Corporate Center, and Richmond Court, all with direct access to Old Oak's state-of-the-art environmental control center. Plus, you can take advantage of the advanced communication solutions and next-generation high-speed data links offered by Group Telecom and London Connects, just two of Old Oak's IT office tenants. Whether it's 500 square feet of the Richmond Row retail boutique, the highly adaptable A-class office tower premises, or the 1,200 to 65,000 square feet of industrial...
So close to ground zero. Michael, thank you for joining us this morning.
You're welcome. It's good to be here.
How has your life changed since September 11th last year?
Well, I guess it's changed in the same way that everyone's lives have changed a little bit, and that is, you know, there's a bit of scar tissue sitting there in the back of your mind, that this kind of thing can happen this close to home, and I certainly think about that. For me personally, you know, I travel a lot on business. I used to travel more, I think. I think I've traveled less. The travel hassles that have been the result of this, you know, make it a little more, make you think about whether you're really going to go and get on a plane and go somewhere.
But it's more time consuming now because of security measures, right?
It is. It's more time consuming. It can be frustrating. You know, I think we all, I used to be famous for complaining about how, about travel hassles, which I don't do anymore. But it can be frustrating to be standing there while someone's looking at a pair of child nail clippers and trying to decide if that little old lady can really get on the airplane or through the security check. I think we understand it, but when it adds an hour or two in each direction of your travel, you tend to say to yourself, maybe I can do this by conference call.
But you are pushing forward. What about the home life? Is that different for you now at all?
Well, I hope it is a little bit. I think what I've done at my home life and in my life in general is I think I spent a little more time thinking about what I should be doing, remembering that you don't know how long you're going to be alive and how long you're going to be healthy, and trying to focus on those good things that I do have. I feel very lucky with working at a great organization, living in a great city, and have a great wife and kids, and try to keep myself in better shape than I used to, and a few things like that. So
it sounds like you're a little bit more aware, maybe somewhat more appreciative of things.
I think that's fair to say. A little more appreciative of the good things that that we all have living in a community like this, and that I certainly have. I certainly feel very fortunate. As I say, I used to complain about travel hassles. It didn't take long after watching that second plane hit the second tower that I thought to myself, I've never had a bad travel day compared to those people. And that's really stuck with me.
Has that been part of the healing process for you? Is that you, not that we can say that good things come of this, but you try to put it that you try to make a positive out of a negative?
Yeah, I think it's very hard for any individual to do anything in particular about this. It's not like I can, you know, make those families in New York feel any better. All I can do is try to move forward. My own views are that I wish they'd, you know, rebuild those towers and get back to doing what they do in a big city like New York, and that is doing business and move on. I understand there's issues about propriety and whether it's a grave site and needs to be treated like that and those kind of issues. But from my point of view, I need to just move on with it and move on with my life and try to do the things I do and enjoy myself to a certain extent.
Michael, thank you very much for coming in this morning. Really appreciate it.
Nice to be here.
London lawyer Michael Peerless. Hawaita?
Thank you very much, Bevan. We are here at Windsor Fire and Rescue Services on Goyo. We're talking a little bit to Sean Boutet. There's a wonderful event that's going on today. Tell us a little bit about what's going to be going on at 9:45 today here.
At 9:45, we're having some guests at the fire hall. They're invitation guests. And throughout North America, at 10:05 and 10:28, there's going to be a ringing of bells. That's simultaneously when the towers fell. We're not marking the attacks themselves. We're not marking the towers falling because that's when most of the lives were lost, when the towers did fall.
And to some degree, what you guys are doing is marking the heroism that occurred that day as well.
That's correct. When the planes hit, emergency service personnel were rushing to the scene and rushing to the scene. No one ever believed those towers would fall. I think to this day, if you watched the programs last night, I don't think anybody still believes those towers are going to fall, but they did fall, and at that time we had numerous amounts of service personnel at that scene.
And what we're trying to do more and more is trying to move forward rather than move backwards. I mean, remember the day, but also be able to move forward and find something positive out of it. And this is something, to some degree, what you guys are going to be doing today.
That's right. It's not as much as a memorial as a tribute to the people who are still out there doing the job every day. Even after the World Trade Center, the call could have went out the next day, and people are still going out, and they're still doing that, and they're still risking their lives every day. That's what we're celebrating today. We're celebrating the hope. We look at the hole now. It's less than a year ago. They had it cleaned up, and people thought it would be years before it be cleaned up. So we're looking for hope, and I think hope is what makes us do our job. We hope that we save a life. We hope we save property, and that's why we go in and do what we do.
Absolutely. Now, tell me personally how this has affected you in a year's time. How has this made you feel being in the profession that you're in?
It affected me in a way that when I watch the things that are going on and I realize how many people have lost their lives and how many families have changed, I've gotten closer with my family. I've got four teenagers, and they're at the stage where they don't even want their mom and dad around.
That's true.
We try really hard to keep up with our kids and make sure that they know our jobs are different, and my job is one that could be here today and gone tomorrow. Let them know that I love them every day and give them a good hug.
I think that's wonderful. Thank you very much, Sean, for joining us. We're going to head over to Matt. And Matt, I mean, Sean is so right. It makes you appreciate things much more, especially a day like today.
12 months later, Hawaii, and I think that's one thing we're definitely sure of, if anything else, is to appreciate everything in our lives. So whatever it is you find special, the sun, the sky, your family, your friends, your pets. And aside from that, I think that's about the only thing we can make sense of. One year later, September 11th.
Absolutely. Make sure you tell all the people that you care about you love them, because tomorrow may never come, right?
You never know what can happen. Thanks very
Absolutely.
Much, Hawaii.
You're very welcome.
Welcome back to London, everybody. We are live from Centennial Hall on Wellington Road in downtown London. The Rolling Requiem is being performed around the world by more than 175 choirs, including here at Centennial Hall this morning. This is Gerald Fagan, who's a part of today's performance.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for coming in so early. Tell us about today's performance. Who's performing it and what is it?
Right. This is a tribute to September the 11th. And this morning at 8:30, the Fagan Singers, the Symphonic Chorus, and the Concert Players Orchestra are performing the Mozart Requiem as part of what is known as the Rolling Requiem, choirs around the world performing the same piece.
Right. It is open to the public?
Oh, yes. It's open to the public. There's no charge. All the players and the singers and the hall have donated their time and money and energy toward this project. And so it's an open community forum for people to come and remember 1 year ago.
Doors open at 7:30 for the public.
Right.
You have to be in your seats by 8:30 at the absolute latest if you want to take part to reflect or remember. If you can't make it down, we will be airing a couple minutes on our show sometime before 9 o'clock, anywhere between 8:46 and 9, so you got to stay tuned for that. More than 175 choirs are taking part in this morning's performance.
Right.
Gerald, what does it mean to you to be a part of it? And 1 year later, where are your thoughts on a day like this?
Well, quite honestly, it's a privilege to be a part of this. It's everybody comes to this sort of event with their own thoughts and concepts and ideas, and I'm exactly the same regardless of whether I'm the conductor or a player or a singer or an audience member. We bring our own remembrances and thoughts, and I do remember back a year ago. And so for me, it's just a personal testament to those people who perished and basically the stupidity of the whole thing.
Certainly.
Yes, sure.
Well, thanks for being with us this morning.
Well, thank you for asking
us. Have a great performance. Oh, our pleasure. Thanks for having us in. The Rolling Requiem this morning at 8:46 down here at Centennial Hall. Come on down if you'd like to take part or stay tuned to New Day. We'll have that and a whole lot more from Centennial Hall and Windsor and the Market. You're watching New Day on Wednesday, September the 11th. We'll be back in a couple minutes.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man? How many...
You are now en route to entertainment, dining, and travel. It's party time at Rainbow Cinemas Galleria. Saturday, September 14th, 10 a.m. to noon. An all-free birthday bash with fun, games, prizes, and 90 minutes of cartoons. It's an evening with Anne Murray and the Hamilton Philharmonic. Saturday, September 28th at Centennial Hall, London. Call 672-1967 for tickets. We'll see you next time en route.
Rod Dench Motors is celebrating 10 years of automotive excellence. Our reputation is important, and that's why our goal is to always exceed your expectations.
They talk to you. They treat you good.
Treat you like somebody.
Your time is valuable. That's why we offer one-stop sales and service and a huge selection of vehicles at exceptional prices.
I bought a truck. He bought a car.
The staff are friendly. Sales people go out of their way to help you out.
Get the lowest price of the year during the celebration at Rod Dench Motors in Ingersoll.
Usually prescribes chicken soup. Well, Chicken Soup for the Soul has been a huge success. Their latest edition, which came out last week, is Chicken Soup for the Canadian Soul. And we thought this would be a suitable day to offer up some chicken soup. One of the authors, Janet Matthews, will be joining us this half hour. Plus, we will check back in Windsor and at Centennial Hall. It is cooler today than it was yesterday, but still sunshine in the forecast. Jay will have the full details after your morning news.
Good morning, I'm Bob Smith. On this, the first anniversary of a series of attacks that saw more than 3,000 people lose their lives on American soil, people are gathering to remember. In New York, the focus will be at the place now known as Ground Zero, once the site of the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center.
I'd like to see it return back to normal as much as possible. Also, maybe dedicating to the people that lost their lives here.
All eyes will be on Ground Zero this morning as New York pays tribute to approximately 2,800 people who died there. There will be 1 minute of silence at 8:46. That was the time when the first jet slammed into the North Tower, followed by a reading of the Gettysburg Address, and then the reading of the names of each of the victims.
We certainly are going to try to do on 9/11 a ceremony that we think balances remembrance with showing the terrorists that they didn't win.
Thousands continue to flock to the site of Ground Zero, which is now a pit seven stories deep. And bells will toll 40 times today at a memorial in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, in remembrance of the 40 victims of Flight 93. Organizers say they expect 20,000 people to attend that ceremony. In this country, the Eves government says it's taken all necessary steps to protect Ontario residents from terrorism. Tuesday, it launched a new volunteer community emergency response system. Retired emergency services workers are being asked to participate.
Our government is investing $1 million annually to help municipalities develop a network of neighborhood-based, multifunctional volunteer teams who will be trained in basic emergency skills. We're looking for volunteers from every walk of life, including retirees.
Our volunteers will be trained in basic medical and life-saving skills, search and rescue operations, as well as the psychology of a disaster. And a significant development in the Middle East today. Palestinians will vote on a new government in January. Palestinian leader Yasser Arafat will send his people to the polls on January 20th. He has been under growing pressure to carry out reforms and weed out corruption and mismanagement. In other news this morning, a sudden change in the weather whipped up high winds and heavy rainfalls, but it appears the town of Ailsa Craig was particularly hard hit. Power was out for several hours in the community of 1,000, about 40 kilometers northwest of London. Fallen branches and toppled trees pulled down power lines. A number of homes and cars were also hit, but no reports of serious injuries. Residents say the wind started to gust around 8, and then it all happened very quickly.
The temperature dropped, the winds picked up, and then the trees and the rain just started coming through, and trees fell on hydro lines, and people, obviously. My grandma was hit by a tree tonight. And it just happened within a matter of 20 minutes, just like that.
How's your grandma?
We're not sure, we're just heading up there.
Well, good news this morning for rail travelers. Things are back to normal for VIA passengers traveling from London to Toronto today. All day yesterday, westbound trains into the city were arriving on time, but the journey east was taking a few new turns. The reason? A freight train derailment near Toronto where 25 cars went off the track. The mess forced VIA trains from London to use the back line through St. Mary's, Stratford, and Kitchener to get to Toronto. That trip takes an extra hour to an hour and a half. Now, crews have repaired the derailment overnight, and that's allowed normal passenger service to resume this morning. In sports, the Jays certainly haven't seen too many of these this year. A winning streak. The Birds picking up their third straight in Cleveland last night. Let's have a look at the highlights. Jays and the Indians at Jacobs Field, and the Indians were their own worst enemies on this night. Second inning, Ken Huckabee drive to right. Routine double play, but Jim Thome's throw allows two runs to score. That is 2-0 Jays. Fourth inning, Indians get on the board. Ellis Burks fires one to right field. That is gone. A two-run shot. And it is tied at 2. Let's go to the sixth inning now. The Jays take the lead again. Dave Berg lines one to left. That turns out to be a double, and it scores a run. And Toronto takes a 3-2 lead. Toronto up 4-2 in the seventh. Victor Martinez gets one to drop in the gap in shallow left. A two-run score on that one. And we're tied at 4. And the Tribe will end it in the ninth. Mark Wohlers turns a double play into the winning Jays run as he throws it to the outfield. Shannon Stewart scores. The Jays beat the Indians 5-4. Tigers and the Twins in Minnesota. First inning, Torrey Hunter hunting for the long ball, and he gets it. Three-run shot. Twins up in a hurry, 3-0. And the Tigers get on the board in the second inning. Yes, yes, you gave that one up, but it's okay. Carlos Pena with a triple to right field scores Robert Fick. And the Tigers are down at this point by 2 runs. From there, though, it's all Twins. Fourth inning, A.J. Pierzynski with a triple to right field. 1 run scores. Damien Easley makes sure A.J. gets home as he sails the throw over Chris Truby. That's a home run with the help of the Tigers. 6-2 Twins. Dustin Moore hammers some insurance in the sixth inning with a solo shot. And Minnesota beats Detroit 11-4.
I will give you $10,000.
You think I want money? What I want is my time back.
It's gonna be bad.
Three new releases hit home video this week. Ben Affleck and Samuel L. Jackson play a game of cat and mouse in changing lanes. An innocent car crash triggers a series of events involving some missing papers and the mob.
I am innocent. May
inform Mercedes that Edmond Dantes has been executed.
My advice, take solace in the comfort of your good friend. No!
The literary classic The Count of Monte Cristo gets the big screen treatment yet again. This time around, Jim Caviezel and Guy Pearce star.
My name's Tom Van Allen.
Your name's Danny Parker.
This is Tom Van Allen.
My name's Danny Parker.
And Val Kilmer turned heads in the indie flick The Salton Sea. He plays a drugged-out police informer on the hunt for his wife's killer. At the movies, I'm Chris Mortensen.
And a couple of 9/11 related DVD releases yesterday. There was one called In Memoriam, which is an HBO special that has a lot of access from the mayor's office, from Giuliani's office, and also has access to literally dozens of different video angles and New York City police and the whole thing. It's a one-hour documentary, very well done. The other one is called Operation Enduring Freedom, which is more about the military action that took place afterwards. So they're both good. And the one that those two French brothers did
that many have seen already.
That is supposed to be released, and I think it's this week, but it wasn't available yesterday as far as we could tell.
All right, thank you very much, Bob.
Okay.
Jay's next with the forecast.
Oh, yes, indeed, we know that people will find a way to go no matter what the man said. Love is fine.
We have a very special guest. Sharon Costello was in New York just before the attacks of September 11th, and it inspired her to produce this CD, which is a wonderful CD entitled Follow in Your Footsteps. This is the CD. It's wonderfully packaged, and it's a beautiful tune. Sharon will be performing it for us live this morning. First, though, we'd like to talk to her about the events that led her to produce this personal tribute to who? Specifically the firefighters here?
Well, all of the heroes of 9/11, including the firefighters, the policemen and women. When the song unfolded for me, I was thinking of anyone who tried to save lives that day, even the gentlemen on flight and women on Flight 93. Images flashed before my eyes of how they went forward and risked everything to try to save lives. So.
Now, you've come up with this product, and an interesting story. Obviously, proceeds from the sale of this are going to charities which are helping out with the relief fund.
Yes.
But you made some personal deliveries.
We did. Last week, my promotional team and I went down to New York City, into Manhattan, into the heart of Manhattan, and to place this CD as a gift from London, Ontario, Canada, which is the way we presented it, was one of the most, these are to the people who suffered the most losses and were affected most directly by this tragedy. I think it was one of the most gratifying things I've done as an artist. And
well, we would love to hear you perform it. Are you ready?
I think I'm ready.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Sharon Costello, Follow in Your Footsteps.
No question at all, only faith. The weight of the world on your back. All around you, the sound of breaking glass. I'll follow in your footsteps if I can. I'm so much braver when I take your hand. Footsteps every day. You can rest now. It's my life, you say. To trade another's life for your own. There's no greater love you can show. I think of you, my hand on my heart. You taught me well, and now it's time to start. To follow in your footsteps if I can. braver when I take your hand. I'm following your footsteps every day. You can rest now, it's my life you saved. The sun always shines after rain. I look up to you somehow. Steps if I can. I'm so much braver when I take your hand. I'll follow in your footsteps every day. Oh, you can rest now, it's my life you saved. If I can, I'm so much braver when I take your hand. I'm following your footsteps every day. You can rest now, it's my life you saved. Follow in your footsteps. 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 Follow in your footsteps.
My heroes. Some people trapped, some people helped. Some people passed, and some people don't. A lot of people are heroes, a lot of people were saved. This is my opinion of my heroes today.
If you're having trouble sleeping, why not go the door?
Day 1 year ago. It is 10 minutes to 8 o'clock. Welcome back to London. Joining us this morning, Janet Matthews, who is one of the co-authors of the latest in the Chicken Soup collection. This one, perfect for us, Chicken Soup for the Canadian Soul, which just hit bookstores last week. Janet, thank you very much for coming in this morning.
You're so welcome, Bevan. I'm so glad to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you, and certainly a day when we need some feel-good stories. And,
yes.
And there are some based around the events or the events shortly after September 11th included in this book, which are very inspiring.
Yes, we have two stories in our collection of stories by and for Canadians that did come as a result of the events of September 11th. And as most people know, Chicken Soup stories are stories of inspiration, they're stories of kindness, of living your dream, of overcoming obstacles. And we have a lot of those stories by some of our celebrated Canadians that we all love, like Terry Fox, like Paul Henderson, like Marilyn Bell. Jan Arden and Kurt Browning have stories in there. But we also have a couple of chapters on making a difference and on kindness. And I think that September 11th, as we all know, we saw some of the worst parts of humanity on that day in the destruction that the terrorists wreaked on New York City. But it also brought out some of the best parts in humanity. And these stories that we have here are, the one story, of course, is how the people in Gander, Newfoundland responded to the crisis. 39 planes came down that morning as they crossed the Atlantic. And Gander is the most easterly part of North America, and there's a large airport there with an airstrip, and so the 39 planes came down there, and the Gander people, there's only 10,000 people in Gander to start with, they suddenly had 6,500 guests.
Wow.
To deal with, and they just opened their hearts, they opened their homes, they fed them, they clothed them, they made sure that their prescriptions got fulfilled, they looked after the old people, they just took care of them for 4 days.
I have
and this story is in there.
I have spent some time in Newfoundland, and I know the hospitality and the generosity there is remarkable.
Yeah.
And they were pressed into service they willingly obliged and did so for quite a few days because those planes were grounded for what, three, 4 days?
I think it was 4 days, yeah. Yeah, I believe. I could be wrong, but I believe it was 4 days.
And Gander is the site of the Canadian commemoration of the events from 1 year ago. The Prime Minister will be speaking live from there.
And that's the reason. That's the reason. 39 planes came down, and those people, you know, did us proud as Canadians.
Thank you very much for coming in. Can you hang around for a little bit?
Sure.
We'd like to talk to you more. There are a couple of stories in here.
Yeah, I've got a story from Senator Jerry Grafstein, who organized the Canada Loves New York weekend a few weeks later. And on December 1st, 26,000 Canadians from all across Canada went to New York to show New Yorkers that we care. And they did it at their own expense.
Well, thank you very much for coming in this morning. We'll talk more about that later.
Okay,
first,
great.
Though, we're off to see Hawaita in Windsor. Hawaita?
Thank you very much, Bevan. We are here at Windsor Fire and Rescue Services. We're talking a little bit about what's occurred. It's September 11th. It's the anniversary, and Dr. Feldbaum is here joining us. You're a psychologist, and you can tell us a little bit about how people may be feeling 1 year after. This is an anniversary. So how do people feel right now, and how do we move forward?
Well, I think most every day that has occurred since the September 11th, there have been reminders of what had happened. But today is a particularly big reminder. So there are all kinds of visual cues and just everybody talks about what happened a year ago. And so the reminders become much more vivid re-experiences of what they've gone through last year. It's like a reawakening.
Is it because it's the anniversary, when it's which would be a reminder, whether it's an anniversary of a death in your family or something like this is a tragedy?
It becomes a really powerful trigger, and it very much is like the death of a loved one. On a particular date, you know that at this time, something happened last year, and because of the significance of this event, for the most part, you know exactly where you were and what you were doing and how you were responding. So when you see that kind of repeated on the news, it brings you literally right back to where you were a year ago. And so whatever emotions you experienced back then, you're likely going to experience now. And it simply is kind of a reawakening.
And that's the norm. I mean, whenever, as you mentioned, whenever there's a tragedy, you tend to remember exactly where I was, what time it was, what I was doing, who I might have been with. Mm-hmm. Now, in order to move forward, though, how do we do that?
Well, I think we move forward in terms of using the anniversaries productively. The anniversary ought to remind me, and I try to make it remind me personally, of what I can do to affect change. There were a tremendous amount of sacrifice by the firefighters and emergency service people, and just the loss of lives. And it's like that has to stand for something. And if it doesn't stand for something, it loses its meaning and its value. So when you have that anniversary, it's like it ought to remind me to be somehow different because of that. Whether it's to be more caring, to extend myself in some way.
Absolutely.
And that way, again, when you look at the tragedy, it isn't just a tragedy. You begin to kind of clothe it with something positive. So that I don't only think of all of the loss, I think about some of the good that it did. Even some of the people that were involved, it's like just showing greater respect for them, being more attentive to what they do. And in some ways, being more attentive to what you do.
Absolutely. Know? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Dr. Feldbaum. When we return, we will be talking with you again as well. But first, we're going to head over to Matt.
Thank you very much, Wada. Welcome back to London, everybody. We are live from Centennial Hall in London, downtown London on Wellington Road, where the Rolling Requiem will be performed at 8:46 a.m. this morning, local time, the time that the first plane struck the first World Trade Center tower in New York City 1 year ago today. If you want to come down and remember and reflect, you're more than welcome to. You have to be in your seats at Centennial Hall by 8:30 a.m. Just before that, there will be an honor guard ceremony, and a part of the honor guard ceremony is Corporal Michael McCoy of the 22nd Service Battalion. 1 year later, Corporal, what are your thoughts? And what does being a part of the ceremony today mean to you?
It was a sad event. And we've done our part to help out, and there's a lot of us that wish we could do more.
Have you changed any elements of your life or any approach to how you approach different parts of your life since 9/11?
Just personal security-wise,
right.
You know? Gotta watch out for that sort of thing. And keep those in mind.
Just appreciation of everyday
exactly.
things.
Exactly. Never forget.
Never forget. You're part of the honor guard ceremony, which is before the Requiem, just before 8:46 a.m. this morning.
Yes.
With the local London and Fire Police, London Fire and Police Services.
Correct.
Very good. Well, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Okay. Rolling Requiem, 8:46 a.m. this morning, live from Centennial Hall. Open to the public. Doors are open. There is no monetary cost to this. If you want to come down and remember and reflect, you're more than welcome to. You have to be in your seats by, at the latest, 8:30 a.m. You're watching New Day on Wednesday, September the 11th, 2002. We'll see you in a couple minutes. Stay tuned.
Maybe this is forever. Forever fades away.
London City Chrysler Jeep and Dodge Truck is proud to be your five-star dealership. That means we're totally committed to delivering complete customer satisfaction. As a five-star dealership, you can be assured of courteous, friendly, competent service, a professional, neat, and clean dealership, trained, knowledgeable employees, and dealership processes designed by our customers. The bottom line is that we're here for you. Discover the five-star difference for yourself at London City Chrysler Jeep and Dodge Truck, Dundas Street East, just west of Clark Road.
You are now en route to entertainment, dining, and travel. It's party time at Rainbow Cinemas Galleria. Saturday, September 14th, 10 a.m. to noon. An all-free birthday bash with fun, games, prizes, and 90 minutes of cartoons. It's an evening with Anne Murray and the Hamilton Philharmonic. Saturday, September 28th at Centennial Hall, London. Call 672-1967 for tickets. We'll see you next time.